Colombia, a land of untold beauty and diverse cultures, long famous for its world-prized coffee, tobacco, and cumbia music, has now become the world's number one producer and exporter of cocaine. Despite 30 years of US-led war on drugs and the fall of flamboyant drug lord Pablo Escobar, the traffic seems healthier than ever, with tens of millions of users and hundreds of billions of dollars of profit. No longer imported from Peru and Bolivia, coca leaves, the primary ingredient of cocaine, are now homegrown in practically all parts of Colombia. Hundreds of thousands of farmers, driven to poverty by the international agribusiness competition, have been hired by the traffickers.
To respond to that, the United States government, working with the Colombian government, has developed what we see as an integral strategy to try to reduce production of cocaine and trafficking in cocaine from Colombia. We believe is essential. The alternative development to give growers of coca, the small growers, the small traditional growers of coca, a genuine economic alternative, an alternative that's environmentally sound as well as economically viable.
If you continue to grow coca or opium poppy, your crops will be destroyed and you will risk going to jail. On the other hand, if you are willing to sign a pact with the Colombian government and its principal implementing agency, Plante, we can give you support and assistance that will allow you to live a decent life and to maintain your family.
La seguridad alimentaria de 2 millones de pesos es
2 million pesos, $950. That's not enough to live. Believe me, a family of five cannot survive 1 year on $950. Not to mention that they have to live not just 1 year, but their whole life. What is provided is very little. For that reason, we think it will be very difficult for the farmers to stop growing coca if the government doesn't give them proper assistance.
No se generaron todas las propuestas de desarrollo que se debiesen haber generado en torno a este programa.
Queremos nosotros y estamos en la posesión, pero que el gobierno nos cumpla lo que nosotros hemos firmado.
Que nosotros los campesinos queremos que el pacto social sea un éxito. Queremos que haya inversión en nosotros. Queremos que nos den un modo de vida. Porque de lo contrario, así como vamos, nos vamos a morir de hambre todos.
Si no hay cumplimiento hasta diciembre que tienen estos convenios, al campesino le sobra fuerzas para seguir cultivando y sembrando más coca.
Evidentemente, los campesinos...
The peasants are the unwilling participants in this process. Unwilling in the sense that they live in abandoned areas, areas where there are no signs of a state, when there is no economic opportunities other than growing coca. And that's what they live off.
De coca porque con eso sobreviven.
It makes a lot of economic sense for campesinos to grow coca because they can convert coca into coca paste on their farm in a small crude lab. And the middlemen, the traffickers, will come to the farm or to the nearest small town and they will buy the coca paste and pay them cash and take it away for them. Now, the heart of U.S. policy requires that these campesinos grow hundreds of kilos of so-called legal crops instead.
Tenemos que pensar en el mercadeo, de que quién nos va a comprar.
We have to think in terms of the market. Who is going to buy the produce we make on our farms? Because if we produce something that nobody wants to buy, then it would be the same thing as not having the produce in the first place.
Nos daría la misma que no tener nada.
But the problem is, we're asking these people to grow you know, hundreds of kilos of yuca and plantains and pineapples and other things that they have to haul to transport on vehicles they don't have, on roads that don't exist, to sell in markets, both internal and export, they don't have access to, and to compete against an international global economy, international agribusiness, against which they don't stand a chance. So this is not a formula for success in terms of alternative development.
Funding for so-called alternative development accounts for less than 20% of President Clinton's original $1.3 billion Plan Colombia package, and even less in President Bush's revised $2 billion Andean Initiative plan. Instead, the core of the U.S. plan rests on spraying defoliant over coca cultures to destroy them, mostly in the south of Colombia.
The Colombian government, supported by the United States government, does use eradication and aerial fumigation as a drug eradication process.
From December 2000, to the 22nd of January, they started the fumigations in five municipalities of the Putumayo. And according to the information we were given by the Colombian government and also by the U.S., in this month and a half of fumigations, 74,000 acres were fumigated, and the result was that a satellite picture taken 1 month later showed that the coca production had actually increased.
The fact is that in this last year, coca production has gone up 11%. It hasn't gone down, it's gone up 11%. So it's not working.
Focusing on the drug producer is a recipe for failure for reasons that you should have learned in Economics 101. Look, a peasant in Putumayo or someplace like that makes the coca paste, can sell a kilo of coca paste for about $1,000. Now that kilo of coca paste gets turned into cocaine that's sold on U.S. streets, gram for more than $100,000, but let's say $100,000. Now imagine that a U.S. spray program does such a good job that the price of coca paste triples to $3,000. All you've done is you've reduced the profit of the middleman from $99,000 to $97,000. That is not success by any measure.
We're a simple people in the United States. We like simple formulas.
The main problem behind this method is that it is a way to just feel good in the end, to keep a clear conscience and be able to say, in the US, something is being done. Coca leaves are being fumigated in Latin America.
The important topic is, what right do the United States have to do anything in Colombia? Well, answer, it has as much right as China has to do something in the United States, namely zero. I mean, for example, does Colombia have a right to bomb Kentucky and North Carolina? That's where they produce the most lethal drugs in the world. I mean, the number of people who die from tobacco is, last figures I looked at, was about 25 times as high as from all drugs combined. But no one believes that other countries have a right to carry out fumigation in North Carolina and Kentucky. And that would be considered outrageous, even if it did work.
For 20 years, fumigating illicit crops in Peru and Bolivia has only resulted in moving coca up and down the Andes. Despite this useless achievement, the U.S. government has made aerial spraying by U.S. contractors the focus of its anti-drug policy in Colombia.
Fumigation itself uses the herbicide glyphosate as its specific fumigation element or chemical.
There are a number of people in the Colombian government that were concerned about the use of this chemical, and they wanted to know what we knew about it.
Glyphosate is probably the most commonly used commercial herbicide in the world. It is used legally in well over 100 countries, including the United States of America.
Glyphosate that's being applied in Colombia is not 100% glyphosate. There's a great deal of other material in that to disperse it and to spread it. Toxicity can be enhanced by the amount of surfactant. And then also you have to think about the altitude at which this material is being sprayed, because the higher you fly, the greater the dispersal, the wider the dispersal. You cannot keep that material that you're really blasting over the surface of the Earth right in a straight, clean ribbon or strip. That's impossible. This material is going to blow around.
My name is Tulio Santander. I was living on a farm in the Putumayo, on a farm over there where they fumigated everything I had. They fumigated my crops of bananas. Bananas not for sale, but for my family's subsistence. I have a wife, I have kids, and they also fumigated the yuca, that fish.
I know now there is concern because there seem to be more skin problems in people who have been exposed to the spraying, who were there when they were actually sprayed upon.
We're engaged in a policy now of aerial fumigation, which I think is a human rights violation, to put it bluntly. I mean, planes are flying up high and spraying, you know, these dangerous chemicals, and not only on coca plants, but on legal crops. They're spraying wells where people get their water to drink. The spray is hitting, you know, young children, babies, you know, pregnant women, elderly.
Well, those are criticisms we've heard a lot, but I don't know that that's entirely true. I would have to look at that more closely to respond fully to it now.
20 to 30 meters up.
They often spray just 20 to 30 meters up in the industrial-sized fields. It is true that particularly when they're spraying heroin or poppy crops, where you're in a more mountainous area, that sometimes they have to fly at higher elevations.
The Monsanto Chemical Corporation was commissioned by the U.S. State Department to provide a defoliant that could be spread on large areas of forest from a safe altitude above insecure territories. The result was Roundup Ultra, a modification of the commercially available Roundup weed killer, with a new formulation which has not been disclosed. With rain and humidity, these deadly chemicals are running into the water supply of the entire Amazon basin, an issue that affects not only Colombia, but parts of Ecuador, Peru, and Brazil as well.
I have, however, not seen any credible scientific evidence, none, that has suggested that this has a harmful environmental impact.
One of the earlier studies discovered that Roundup or glyphosate actually interferes with enzyme systems in the thyroid, in the brain, the liver, and the pancreas. And one of the studies actually showed that glyphosate caused tumors in the thyroid and also in the pancreas and in the Leydig cells or the testicles. These are the cells that are critical for sperm production in the male.
I mean, you know, we've been through that before where, you know, we use different herbicides and, you know, I think of Vietnam vets and Agent Orange, and everybody's told that they're fine, that there's no problem, and then later on we find that it's highly correlated to cancer or terrible illness.
Look at the children and the grandchildren of the people who were there who were exposed. It's a horror story. And we found out that dioxin had a lot of effects on a lot of different systems. But, you know, 40 years later, are we going to wait 40 years before we get the truth out of this?
The people in Colombia have every right to be concerned, and I think we have to do it differently.
A few years ago, the RAND Corporation, a very conservative think tank, does a lot of consulting for the military, was commissioned by the Army and by the U.S. Drug Czar's office to do a study called Controlling Cocaine.
They compared several methods of dealing with the drug problem. One method is prevention and treatment. That was by far the most cost-effective. The next one was police measures at home. That, I think, was about 1/7 as cost-effective as prevention and treatment. The next was border interdiction. That was 1/11 as effective. The next was out-of-country operations, like fumigation in Colombia. There, the ratio was 23-1 in favor of prevention and treatment. That's just in terms of cost-effectiveness.
So we are pursuing the least cost-effective method of reducing drug use in the United States, if that is truly what we're concerned about.
It is really strange that both the Colombian and American governments focus their anti-drug efforts on the periphery of the problem and not on its center of gravity. The center of gravity of the problem is the drug traffickers, and they are not attacked.
While the policy of aerial spraying has proven largely ineffective, the production of cocaine has actually doubled over the last 10 years. The question then becomes, why spend billions of dollars on a proven failure and not on domestic prevention rehabilitation programs?
Originally, when the Colombian president came to the United States with the idea for Plan Colombia, it was not primarily a military plan. It was to find alternative crops, it was for economic development. But when it got to the United States, a heavy military stamp was put on it by the Pentagon. So now we have a situation where out of $1.7 billion over the next few years, 80% of it will go for military purposes.
Not a single moment was Plan Colombia discussed directly by the Colombian Congress. Major decisions were made by the executive branch and by the U.S. State Department. That was the style of the negotiation.
To give a sense of the priorities in the Congress, one of the biggest debates when Plan Colombia was debated on the floor was how many helicopters should be built in Texas at Bell Helicopter Textron. How many would be built in Connecticut at Sikorsky Helicopter? So rather than debating, you know, is a military solution to the drug war possible, what will be the impacts on the people of Colombia, they were arguing over the money. You know, is the company in my state going to get it? Is the company in Texas going to get it? So it was sort of one of the less dignified moments in the American foreign policy debates.
Not a single European country and not a Latin American country has openly and wholeheartedly supported our approach in Colombia. They see it as too militarized, and they see it as a failure as far as drug policy goes. That is an indication that there must be something wrong with the overall approach.
It's not so much an aid program as another way to subsidize the military-industrial complex in the United States.
In this case, much of the money is going to end up with helicopter companies. Sikorsky, which makes the Black Hawk helicopter, will be getting almost $250 million, and Bell Helicopter, which makes the upgrades for the Huey, is going to get somewhere in the neighborhood of $100 million.
Besides channeling billions of U.S. taxpayers' dollars into U.S. arms-making corporations, the State Department has resorted to sending private mercenaries instead of regular American military personnel to carry out missions in Colombia.
There are not U.S. military personnel engaged in any kind of military operations in the country. The contractor situation is an interesting one, and in many ways, it's not particularly a military issue.
When you use private military contractors, you don't have the same kinds of oversight, the same kind of accountability that you have when you use GIs.
The reason we are outsourcing this war, privatizing this war, is because we don't have the kind of public support in this country to put U.S. military service personnel in the line of fire. And so we're resorting to the private sector to carry out these functions.
So this is a under-the-radar kind of war, a little secret war, that the United States is using its taxpayer dollars to engage in.
A lot of Americans don't realize what a substantial military effort the United States is making in Colombia. But actually, Colombia is the third largest recipient of U.S. military aid after Egypt and Israel.
There's always been a concern in providing assistance to Colombia because they've been, in effect, a civil war for 30 years.
Much older than the current drug war situation, Colombia's civil strife is as old as the country itself. Originating in colonial racism and oligarchy, The social conflict develops as Colombia evolves into an industrial society, divided between a tiny rich elite and a poor working majority. While the haves and have-nots blame each other for initiating violence, it is the assassination in 1948 of a charismatic populist leader, Jorge Eliezer Gaitan, that leads to a social explosion that Colombians themselves refer to as La Violencia. With the backing of a conservative government, anti-leftist landowners and industrialists sent hordes of thugs against rioting students, workers, and peasants, forcing them to the countryside where they formed the first guerrilla movements. As the world seems on the verge of a global confrontation between capitalism and socialism, Washington makes it a priority to back a pro-Western Colombian establishment and train its military and so-called paramilitary groups to try to wipe out the now entrenched leftist guerrillas. Despite millions of dollars spent and the training of over 10,000 Colombian officers in counter-guerrilla tactics, the Colombian military never manages to prevail. In the early 80s, the war actually gets worse as narco-traffickers become players in this conflict with more money and sophisticated weapons. From now on, even though officially aimed against drugs, Washington's enormous infusion of arms and equipment to the Colombian military has been catalyzing a renewed assault against the leftist rebels.
The only impact that Plan Colombia has on the guerrilla is that there are more U.S. military advisors, more warplanes, more helicopters, more war. And every time they increase the war against the guerrilla answers with more war to defend itself.
Igualmente con más guerra para poderse defender.
If you call them narco guerrillas, you can then turn on people that are prosecuting a civil war and consider them to be drug runners, and then you can use the same helicopters and weapons and pilots against the people in the civil war saying, well, they're drug runners.
Unen dos variables como si fueran una sola.
They combine these two factors as if it was only one, the guerrilla and narco-trafficking. This is wrong because the guerrilla, for instance, in the Putumayo, was there long before the cultivation of coca.
Única y exclusivamente cobramos el impuesto a quienes cobran.
What we do only is that we raise a tax on people who buy from the farmers. We do the same thing with the import and export of many other commercial products in Colombia.
De muchos otros productos comerciales en Colombia.
La guerrilla tiene un proyecto.
The guerrilla had a political agenda that originally fitted the classic Marxist pattern of classless society, what is known as the proletariat dictatorship. Today, they don't stand for the same thing. Today, they are open to an agenda including economic, political, and social propositions to transform today's society.
Colombia is a sociedad in conflicto.
Colombia is a struggling society. In Colombia, every week, every day, there are strikes, demonstrations, roadblocks in the countryside and around cities. This is the result of a crisis, of the anguish felt by 22 million Colombians living in poverty.
There are an additional 8 million Colombians who live in absolute poverty, and this gives us a total of 30 million Colombians out of a total of 40 million Colombians. Such a society is bound to generate discontent, political organizing, and social struggle.
Many young people have opted for joining armed guerrilla groups. There are no real political alternatives, and often no other political groups. The mentality of Colombia doesn't allow for other solutions.
In Colombia and abroad, an enormous controversy surrounds the FARC guerrilla. It is seen by some as a popular movement of liberation for the poor, oppressed majority of Colombia. It is viewed by others as a criminal organization terrorizing the country. And indeed, while it is not clear exactly how involved the FARC is in the various aspects of producing coca and cocaine, it is a fact that the movement relies heavily on kidnappings and extortion to fund its activities. On the other side, the paramilitaries that are opposing them are much worse, carrying out assassination and massacres on a weekly basis and controlling a wide, vertically integrated portion of cocaine trafficking.
The official rhetoric tries to depict the paramilitary groups and their actions as if they were totally independent of the state, as if they were a third party within the conflict. This, I believe, is a false image.
There are entirely too many linkages between the paramilitary and the military, entirely too many documented cases of the paramilitary slaughtering innocent people, civil society people, with the military either knowing about it and not doing anything, or basically turning away from it, not going in to defend people. And I think that's unconscionable.
Lo que nosotros señalamos claramente en nuestro informe es
what we have clearly shown in our reports is the responsibility of the state in instigating paramilitary actions and letting them carry out atrocities, massacres, and assassinations.
Atrocidades, masacres, muertes selectivas.
Barranca Bermeja, a city entirely devoted to the oil industry, an hour flight north of Bogota. It is also a city in one of the most violent regions of Colombia. Once a stronghold of the ELN guerrilla, it has since been taken over by paramilitary militias that managed to kick the guerrilla out of town. The paramilitaries have been gradually murdering all FARC and ELN known sympathizers to the satisfaction of the police and the army, who are essentially their allies against the leftist rebels.
There are some who say that Barranca Bermeja has changed. I'd rather say that Barranca changed leadership. Barranca's situation has changed. Nobody can dispute that. But in no way can anyone say that tranquility justifies massacres, assassinations, and social cleansing, as they say. And all of these arbitrary practices that we have to reject and condemn.
In the last 2 weeks, two people of our project are being killed. A woman, Alma Rosa Jaramillo, who was a lawyer, she was killed. Her body was totally destroyed by the paramilitaries. And last week, Eduardo Estrada, a peasant, was also killed by the paramilitary groups.
About 80% of the extrajudicial killing and murdering of innocent people is now being done right now by the paramilitary.
We have had incursions of self-defense groups, but they were incursions directed at people belonging to subversive groups. The civilian population was not targeted. They came, and they know why they were coming. They did what they had to do.
Los paramilitares están combatiendo.
The paramilitaries are fighting social and political organizations. What they want is not so much to rid the country of the guerrilla as it is to get rid of all workers' unions, of all peasant, indigenous, or human rights organizations, of all political parties of opposition.
Sin partidos políticos de oposición.
We don't have institutions supporting us. I can, for instance, I cannot go to the military to ask them to protect me or to protect the projects we are working with people in this area, because I can't trust them.
El ejército en Colombia no se ha...
The army in Colombia is not convinced that its most important task is to protect the civilian population. The army thinks that its priority is to destroy the guerrilla, not to protect the population.
La protección de la población.
Focused on destroying all leftist opposition in Colombia, the military and paramilitary do not differentiate between guerrillas and political or social activists. Communities located in areas controlled by the FARC or the ELN are also perceived as enemy and heavily victimized. This phenomenon accounts for a massive internal displacement of rural populations that eventually seek refuge into town. With 1.5 million displaced and often living in sordid conditions, Colombia today has the third largest population of internal refugees in the world.
Displacing populations is part of a military strategy. This is also part of the strategy of other armed groups as well. It is a phenomenon that is responding to military, political, and economic interests. It all depends on which zone we're talking about.
The reality in Barranca Bermeja and the Magdalena Medio is no different from most parts of the country where institutions seem to have disintegrated from inside, worn by the acid of fear, corruption, intolerance, and racism. Even more so than other communities, Afro-Colombians have had to suffer the full force of military and paramilitary terror.
Ejemplo, en el departamento del Chocó, en su zona norte, hubo algunas...
In the department of Chocó in the north, there were communities that were bombarded by the national forces of Colombia and that were attacked by both the military and the paramilitary. Massacres were carried out, and eventually some of our people were forced to abandon their lands. We're talking here about an area of paramount strategic importance for the world's biodiversity. And for that reason, they are displacing our people who collectively own these territories.
They showed up on June 10th exactly. It was a rather large group. We, as a community, didn't get a chance to count them because our policy is not to interact with any irregular armed party. But many delegates from national and international non-governmental organizations were there, and they confronted this group. Later, they gave us a report that there were 200 soldiers, both paramilitary and military, from different battalions of the Colombian army.
The next day, on
the morning of the 11th, the paramilitaries came back, mixed with soldiers from the Colombian army. They were firing grenades and gunshots at the village. People started running everywhere. Several people got wounded. And they took a man. They tied him up. They tore his clothes off. They castrated him. And they killed him bit by bit. They were throwing his body parts to the dogs. People were caught in a frantic panic. Mothers were grabbing children that were not theirs because in panic you can't see anymore. Women were fleeing in the river. Some ran naked as they could towards the jungle. They attacked the civilian population, but there was no guerrillas. Even if they say that the paramilitaries are a separate group, this is not true. The paramilitaries are the offspring of the military.
Right now, the U.S. should be telling the Colombian military that we're not going to give them one penny in military assistance until they clean up their act, until they sever all ties with paramilitary groups.
Reports from Human Rights Watch, from the U.S. State Department, clearly document the connection between the Colombian military and these paramilitary groups. They receive intelligence from the Colombian military, they receive aid, they receive training, they're in direct communication through meetings on military bases, through beepers and cell phone communications that have been documented.
Definitely, there is no such thing as a relationship or a collaboration between the armed forces and the paramilitary. This has never happened and will never happen.
July 23rd, 2001. The arrest of General Rito Alejo del Rio makes the Colombian headlines. He is the highest ranking Colombian army officer ever to be officially exposed for complicity in paramilitary violence. He is also one of the many Colombian officers who graduated from the U.S. Army School of the Americas.
I began to do more and more investigation of other graduates of the school, finding that, some of the worst human rights abusers in Central America, in Panama, in Colombia, are graduates from this school.
The School of the Americas was founded by the U.S. government in 1946 at the beginning of the Cold War. First set in Panama, then relocated to Fort Benning, Georgia. It is renamed Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation in 2001 to try to dodge public pressure and an attempt by Congress to shut it down. The School of the Americas has been training over 60,000 officers from all over Latin America with one clear mission: different from traditional military schools.
The Kennedy administration changed the mission of the Latin American military, which of course it controlled. It changed it from hemispheric defense, that's a holdover from the Second World War, to internal security. Internal security is a euphemism, which means war against your own population. It armed and trained the Latin American military forces to carry out this war. That led to a huge plague of repression throughout the continent as military dictatorships took over, brutal, murderous ones with U.S. support.
This counterinsurgency warfare, this low-intensity conflict strategy, has been used to terrorize the civilian population, to make everyone afraid to have anything to do with the guerrillas or to give any appearance of support for the guerrillas.
In Colombia, the Kennedy administration sent a mission, a special forces mission, in 1962 to advise the Colombians on how to deal with their internal problems. Their advice was to resort to paramilitary terror against known communist proponents. The term communist means anyone who's independent. So it could be priests organizing peasants, human rights activists, labor leaders. That's what communist means. Non-communist proponents have to be subjected to paramilitary terror.
There's always economic interests directly related to this military and paramilitary action against civilians. For example, we see in Colombia the most intense massacres of civilian populations happen in areas where key economic interests are at stake.
I think part of the plan and part of the interest of the United States in Colombia is not really so much about narcotics. It's about having a friendly regime in Colombia that can implement friendly free market policies that are friendly to U.S. corporations, friendly to the whole notion of expanding NAFTA into Latin America. And obviously that can't be done in a country that's in the middle of fighting a guerrilla war.
The free trade agreement of the Americas is very much a part of development in our mind.
One of the main reasons we want to preserve the status quo, of course, is so that we can buy and sell and make a profit and open up markets. And it makes sense that the FTAA would be going hand in hand with increased military assistance.
Our belief is that by linking Colombia with the other countries of the Andean region in a hemispheric approach that will reduce trade barriers and non-tariff obstacles to trade, Colombia, like the rest of the region, can in fact improve economically through trade.
The Free Trade Agreement of the Americas is the latest attempt by the U.S. government to eliminate trade barriers and labor and environmental regulations. The intent is to open wide and large the doors of Latin America to U.S. corporations and exports. Ever since the early days of the infamous United Fruit Company, U.S. military assistance has played a major part in consolidating dictatorships more friendly to U.S. corporations than to their own populations. Today, though, fruit is no longer the prime concern as the world's oil reserves are rapidly dwindling. While the U.S. wants to reserve its own oil in case of global conflict, it has also sought for many years to limit its dependency on faraway Middle Eastern oil. As a result, Venezuela has now become the second largest oil supplier to the U.S. But Colombia holds a similar promise, with the bonus of a friendlier regime to Washington, as long as the guerrilla does not prevail.
Colombia pasó.
Over the past decade, Colombia went from producing 100,000 barrels of oil per day to now producing close to 900,000 barrels a day. Colombia is now the seventh largest provider of oil to the U.S. To give you an idea, Venezuela produces 1,600,000 barrels a day, Colombia 900,000, and nobody pays attention. And it is also a sweet deal for foreign companies because Colombia went from having a 50-50 profit sharing with these companies to offering now a 75% deal in favor of multinational corporations with only 25% in favor of the Colombian government.
Del gobierno colombiano.
So for companies like Occidental, which have significant oil interests in Colombia, they certainly view this as an extension of their interests, that if they could somehow pacify the guerrilla groups or transform them through the threat of warfare somehow into a less threatening political element, that therefore their ability to invest there and to make Colombia part of this sort of free market area of the Americas would be therefore much easier.
The fumigation is taking place primarily in guerrilla-held areas, even though the paramilitaries are as deeply, if not more deeply, involved in the drug trade. So that has led many of us to say that this policy has more to do with counterinsurgency than counter-narcotics.
So you see that as soon as the oil production increases in Colombia, so does the U.S. military presence, with $1.3 billion supposedly devoted to fighting drugs, when we are well aware that the focus of military intervention is precisely in areas with major oil interests.
It's because the energy resources of the world have to be under U.S. control. As far as Latin America, it's pretty much what George Kennan said 50 years ago. We have to protect our resources. Notice our resources. I mean, they happen to be in somebody else's country, but that's kind of accidental.
Many open or covert U.S. interventions abroad seem to have followed George Kennan's motto of protecting our resources. No means have been spared to secure territories and resources, even if it meant making deals with questionable allies. In Vietnam, when the French are defeated in 1954, the U.S. military intelligence keeps the French connection in place, a network by which anti-communist Hmong tribes were allowed to export their opium to Europe and then to the United States to fund their war against the Viet Minh.
Laos in the 1960s, the tribal warlords that were allied with the CIA opened a complex of 7 heroin refineries. They began exporting the heroin to South Vietnam, where a peak of 34% of all U.S. combat forces fighting in South Vietnam in 1971 were regular heroin users, according to a White House survey.
The same phenomenon re-emerged in Afghanistan in 1980 when the CIA enlists the help of Pakistani and Afghan opium warlords against the Soviet invaders. The very same alliance is resurrected against the Taliban in 2001. Opium cultivation eradicated by the Taliban as part of their proclaimed moral order is reintroduced on a larger scale than before by the new U.S. allies, the Northern Alliance. Their heroin is now flooding Europe and the United States, while U.S. military aircraft fly daily over their gigantic poppy fields.
During the Contra operation, the Contras may have used the cocaine traffic in order to gain funds to conduct their operations. Same pattern appears to be recurring in Colombia, where we are going to be working at least indirectly through the Colombian military with the so-called militias, who are directly connected to the major drug traffickers.
What is going on in Colombia is that there is so many people involved in the growing distribution, trafficking of plants, drugs, that it's very hard to tell who's what. I mean, this isn't just a matter of one side being involved in drug running as opposed to nobody else. It's endemic in the country.
You have to know that in Colombia, all the violence and the corruption are financed by the drug traffickers. And the traditional, most corrupt political establishment is also financed by drug trafficking. The problem is that we are giving billions of dollars of U.S. assistance to a corrupt Colombian government.
While U.S. military assistance under Plan Colombia keeps pouring onto a dubious Colombian government and military, an estimated 400 billion narco dollars in solid cash are still freely moving about the world's largest financial institutions every year, without anybody apparently noticing anything.
As far as money laundering is concerned, it's true. 20 years ago, at the beginning of the first war on terror, George Bush was vice president. He was drug czar. He was in charge of drugs. There was an effort in Florida. In Florida, they discovered, the federal prosecutors, that there was a big flow of money suddenly coming into Florida banks. Everybody knew where it was from. They started an investigation. Bush intervened to call it off. That was the last effort to trace narco money in the United States.
What I would say is that I think governments work closely together, and their investigative authorities, I think, work very closely together to try to deal with that problem of money laundering.
Very repeatedly, there have been bills introduced in Congress trying to stop money laundering, but they've never succeeded, mainly because of the power of the banking lobby. That is so much money that goes into U.S. banks and that goes into our economic system as a result of drug trafficking and much other illegal activity as well.
Nobody knows the details of the drug trade because it's illicit. But there are studies. So the OECD did a study, and I think their estimate was that about half the narco-trafficking money passes through U.S. banks.
That U.N. report, which was done in 1997-98 for the big U.N. conference on narcotics at the General Assembly, the U.N. report concluded that the global traffic in all illicit drugs represents 8% of world trade. The traffic in illicit narcotics is larger than the trade in textiles, which is a human fundamental. Food, shelter, clothing are the three human fundamentals. Well, illicit narcotics, as international trade, is larger than one of those three human fundamentals. So the attempt to apply crude instruments of repression, police, law, and military, to a global narcotics traffic is simply irrational.
You know, Congress can repeal a lot of laws, but the law of supply and demand is not one of them.
There's an enormous demand for the drugs in the United States, and what we don't do in our own country is provide for the drug treatment programs.
But the drug treatment budget is nowhere near meeting national needs in most U.S. cities. An addict reaches the point where they want help and they want treatment is usually turned away. They say, come back in a few months, we should have a slot open for you. There's just not enough money. Meanwhile, it's always easy to get in jail. There's no waiting list to get in jail. And that really reflects our priorities, I'm afraid.
In February 2002, with a large part of the U.S. military package under Plan Colombia already delivered, Colombian President Andres Pastrana abruptly ends the negotiations with the FARC guerrilla. The U.S. State Department under President Bush officially shifts its priority in Colombia from counter-narcotics to counter-insurgency, conveniently dubbed anti-terrorism. The war on drugs smokescreen has served its purpose. Plan Colombia is no longer needed as a cover.
If we don't reduce the demand for drugs in the world, then in countries like Colombia, somebody's always going to grow it. As long as there's a market, as long as big money can be made, it's going to continue to go on.